the continued focus on important sectors such as sanitation, education, water, manufacturing are welcome. It will continue to keep India on track to achieving its sustainable development goals. We will all be eagerly looking forward to its successful implementation. Further, providing for the viability gap funding for the setting up of effective warehouses, hospitals, medical colleges are reformative proposals. It will encourage private investments and open up these sectors even more. Mr. Speaker, there are certain concerns that I'm sure we all have on our minds. First and foremost among them is how the revenue deficit will be addressed, and the reduction of revenue not only hurts the central government but also the states. The devolution of taxes to the states is equally hurt. Adding to this, the 15th Finance Commission has also reduced the devolution of Andhra Pradesh from 4.3% to 4.11%. This has resulted in loss of nearly 1500 crores. The estimated fiscal deficit this year is 3.8% of GDP. However, if the extra budgetary borrowing amounting to 1,72,000 crores are included in the calculation, the fiscal deficit will increase to 4.6% of the GDP. Similarly, if the extra budgetary expenditure for 2020-2021 is taken into account, the estimated fiscal deficit would increase from 3.5 to 4.4% for the GDP. I would like the Finance Minister to clarify whether this has been accounted for or not. The government also pinned its hope on disinvestment to arrange for funds. In the financial year 2019-2020, the government has a target of 1,05,000 crores. Instead, it was able to achieve only 65,000 crores. In the coming year, the government has planned to raise 1,20,000 crores through investment. We are eagerly waiting with high hope that the government meets its target this time without actually letting go of its prize jewels. While it is appreciable that the bank deposit insurance has been increased to 5 lakhs from the previous 1 lakh, there are many issues to be sorted. The repo rate has been reduced to 5.15%, the lowest in nearly a decade. Even this has failed to translate into increased number of loans to industries, especially the MSMEs. GST collection between April and November fell by 40%, and it is likely to be lower than the growth target of 25%. The slow pace at which GST dues are transferred to the states has been troubling, especially for Andhra Pradesh, which has already had a deficit revenue due to bifurcation. A mechanism needs to be developed for speedy disbursement of revenue to the states. Coming to agriculture, PM Kisan scheme, which has been promised so much, but it has not been delivered that much. The budget allocation has remained constant. Until now, only 43,000 crores has been distributed out of 75,000 crores. The lack of actual distribution of funds has been extremely low as compared to the budget allocation. The delay in reaching out to the farmers hurt their livelihood. We need to find the reasons for these delay payments and lack of disbursement of funds. Because we are coming up with a new one, PM Kusum, wherein we are going to give solar panels to the farmers. If we can't find the farmers to actually disburse PM Kisan, it will be very difficult to actually deliver the PM Kusum scheme. I would also like to bring to your attention that the YSR Raitu Bharosa scheme, farmers that is being implemented in Andhra Pradesh. Farmers are being provided input assistance of almost 13,500 rupees annually to 46 lakh farmers. The government must consider increasing the budget allocation under PM Kisan for Andhra Pradesh, which has successfully extended the scheme to actual tiller of the land. The budget allocation for PM Fasal Bima Yojana has increased only marginally by rupees 1700 crores to 15,700 crores. Considering the farmer distress prevailing in India, the government should hike the allocation budget for the scheme. A primary concern of successive governments has been to double farmers' income. For this to happen, there must be a comprehensive plan to tackle this issue. The main source of this supplementary income is livestock and dairy. This income too is under threat and diminishing every day. The lack of adequate fodder has resulted in lower milk production and malnutrition among the livestock. We are neither importing nor producing sufficient fodder. According to a Cornell University study, a deficit of 65% of green fodder and 25% of dry fodder is expected for Indian livestock by 2025. Sir, the revised estimate for the MNRG program has already overshot in the 2019-2020 budget estimate by 11,000 crores. Yet, the allocation for the program for the coming financial year is pegged at 61,500 crores. I would hope and also recommend that in light of slowdown of the economy and the current rate of unemployment, the government consider increasing the allocation of the program. It should also ensure that the pending dues are cleared with immediate effect and funding for the same is ensured on time. It was good to see that the government will create warehousing and build a seamless national coal supply chains for perishables through PPP arrangements. However, the details of the same are not clear. I would really appreciate if the details are given out in clear. The government has increased the allocation for education to 99,300 crores. However, the rate at this rate, 6% of the GDP allocation by 2022 seems distant. The new education policy which we're bringing out has sought to introduce many new ideas and innovations. It is apparent that to properly implement the new education policy, the budgetary allocation would have to be at least 3% of the GDP. The Honorable Finance Minister in her speech had also stated that she would like to have world-class institutions. However, building is easy, but staffing them with quality faculty and providing state-of-the-art resources require adequate long-term funding. I would also like to take this opportunity to bring to your attention that the Andhra Pradesh government has initiated two schemes. One is Ammavadi and the other one is Nadu Nedu. Through Ammavadi, they are giving out 15,000 rupees to the mother on every January. We have reached out to 43 lakh mothers. Through Nadu Nedu program, we are refurbishing almost 15,715 schools. These are shared goals, and the cooperation between the center and state would ensure that the success of these schemes, while at the same time reducing the fiscal burden on the Andhra Pradesh. I would hope the finance minister will try to support us. And I would also like to urge the government to keep its promise of setting up 12 national institutes in Andhra Pradesh. Currently, a partly sum of 2,200 crores has been sanctioned for only 7 institutes. Out of this, only 1,000 crores has been released. I hope the government will release funds according to what was mandated. Along with education, healthcare needs to be given due importance. The government has increased the budget allocation by just 5%. So the government has a target to allot 2.5% of the GDP to healthcare by 2025. But in light of 15% healthcare inflation in India, this target would be difficult to achieve without higher allocation. It is good that government seeks to empanel 2,000 hospitals in aspirational districts, but I hope that it will also address the dues already owed to the empaneled hospitals amounting to nearly 1,600 crores. While we are in the midst of this slowdown, the government must lend a hand to struggling industry. The overall credit gap in MSME sector is estimated to be around 20 to 25 lakh crores, and this is despite the fact that the sector accounts for almost 11 million jobs and over 40% of the exports, 28% of the GDP. The NBFCs needs to be blasted to ensure that adequate credit is available in the market, especially for the manufacturing sector. The Honorable Minister, Finance Minister, pointed out that the Indian imports significantly technical textiles worth almost $16 billion every year. In a bid to reverse this, the government has allocated nearly 1,500 crores for this mission. Such initiatives, we very much welcome these initiatives. However, I would also urge the government to also consider its allocation to Ministry of Textiles. The ministry has been allotted a meager 3,500 crores. In fact, the allocation for this Ministry of Textiles has fallen by 1,300 crores. Weavers and textile industries across the country are facing stiff competition for cheap imported products from Bangladesh and Vietnam. The textile industry in India is the second largest employer in the country, and the ministry is very much aware here. I hope it will take it up to the finance ministry. It is a $100 billion industry that provides employment to 45 million people directly and 60 million people indirectly. I don't have to give these details to you, but I hope the textile ministry will be taking care, and I hope it will be taken care, and extra infusion will be done, because it's very personal to me, because from my district we have the highest number of textile mills, ginning mills and spinning mills that are there. I hope you'll take care of them. I hope something will be sorted out. The Honorable Finance Minister has allocated 103 lakh crores for the national infrastructure pipeline and has covered 6,500 projects under it. This is an ambitious and commendable target that will spur desperately required growth and employment. The past record of this government has been admirable. However, there are still many projects that have been delayed. For example, the Bharatmala, Sagarmala, river linking projects and construction of inland waterways has been delayed. It would also benefit the members of this house if the Honorable Minister would elaborate in great detail as how it intends to implement the PPP model and provide viability gap funding. I would also urge the Honorable Minister to include the projects from Andhra Pradesh which require government funding within the national infrastructure pipeline. Much of these were promised on the AP Reorganization Act but still not been delivered by the central government. Firstly, the Polavaram project is a lifeline of successful Andhra Pradesh. It has been declared a national project. Government of Andhra Pradesh has incurred an expenditure of 11,800 crores on Polavaram national project as on 4th January 2020. Furthermore, the revised cost estimate for 55,548 crores was cleared by Technical Advisory Committee of Ministry of Water Resources. However, it is still pending approval with the revised cost estimates. Secondly, the government of Andhra Pradesh has even undertaken an ambitious plan to create a water grid to supply clean drinking water of 45 litres to each household. I hope this will be taken care of. Another key assurance in AP Reorganization Act was establishing integrated steel plant in YSR Kadapa district. And we have been promised four smart cities, Visakhapatnam, Tirupati, Amaravati and Kakinada, with a budget of 9,000 crores. I hope that budget will be released soon. I also hope that the central government push for the growth in Visakhapatnam-Chennai corridor and also release funds for the crucial Amaravati Expressway as well, Amaravati-Anantapur Expressway. Finally, I would like to reiterate that the Government of India, in its own wisdom, bifurcated AP and former Prime Minister has assured us the special category status would be given to the residual state. The overall financial position of Andhra Pradesh is very precarious, and the only way to bring the state out of financial crisis and attract investment and provide a level playing field is by granting the special category status, sir. Therefore, through you, I request the Honourable Prime Minister to grant Andhra Pradesh special category status, and I request the Honourable Finance Minister to provide adequate funding to Andhra Pradesh. I hope these concerns will be addressed.
Please, sir, conclude, Krishna.
With this, I wish the government the best for its endeavour, and I hope it will take into consideration these addresses and do it. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.